In addition to all of your work with English-speaking artists, you've also worked quite a bit with Latin, Asian, and European artists who Americans might not know but are huge sellers in their native countries.
Yeah.
Are you surprised some of them haven't become better known in the States, or do you think it even matters to them?
I think all of them would love to be able to make it here, but most of them perform in their native language, and they're just not going to get anywhere in the States if they're not singing in English. That, I mean, it's a sad commentary, but I worked for many, many years with Veronique Sanson, who's like the Joni Mitchell of France. She used to be married to Stephen Stills, and first time I worked with her was in 73, and then I toured all through the 90s with her and recorded over in Europe. And she speaks fluent English, but all of her albums are in French. And there's a girl named Yumi Matsutoya, who's like the kind of the rock goddess of Japan. And I've done, I think, 26 albums with her, but everything's in Japanese. So other than maybe, you know, a small community within the States that's aware of them, they're not going to get airplay. Where the Latin market here is better because there's so many people of Latin descent. It's a pretty vital music scene. So they don't get like mainstream radio, but they have pretty strong stations of their own.
Well, I'm going to play a track now by an American artist, but a person who can definitely claim to have international appeal. This track required a pretty understated part from you. It's Evergreen from the film A Star Is Born. And since Barbra Streisand's lead vocal is so much the focal point of the track, I was wondering if it was there already when you were tracking the bass, or if she added it later, or
she
if
sang
you tracked
live
at the same
that.
Time. Yeah. Knowing her MO, I would have figured she tracked with you.
Yeah, no, I love Barbra. I mean, you know, she's one of these people that a lot of people rag about her, but I think they rag because she's the consummate professional, and if somebody isn't carrying their weight, she lets them know. And a lot of people are kind of slackers, so you just, you know. But I've always enjoyed working with her, and I really enjoyed that project. Pat Williams, I think, did the conducting and arranging on it, and we did it with the orchestra live, and it's cool. Well, that's when it's really exciting, when you hear everything in your phones and not guessing.
There's a thrill when you play with the live orchestra that you don't get any other way.
Well, you're also, it becomes performance at that point. Yeah. You're not just sitting there in this isolated little capsule. When you put on those headphones, you're hearing the finished product there. Yeah. I mean, they're mixing it. You know, any chance I get to do those kind of things, I love it. You know, there's something so exhilarating about hearing all of it at once.
Well, there's a lot of sort of ringing whole notes in your bass part, and also some fills that work within her vocal.
You have to listen. You have to respond to the song. It's not about you. It's about the song and the artist. I have no problem if all I need to do is play a whole note, I'm happy to give them the best whole note I can.
Mm-hmm. Well, another thing about her recordings, it ties into what you said about, you know, perfectionism or whatever. Her recordings sound expensive to me in the sense that, not in a wasteful sense, but in the sense that no expense was spared to make that track the very best it could possibly be.
Yeah, but the thing is, actually, in the long run, it was probably cheaper because you, number one, had everybody in the studio at the same time, so you weren't renting the studio multiple days to add strings and then a horn session and this and that. You had everybody do it one time, and it's over.
Yeah.
You know, and that, to me, makes so much sense, but that requires preparation. So you need your arrangements right. You need your copyists working and proofreading everything, and so it requires a diligence, but the end result, I think, is better.
Yeah. Well, speaking of the end result, let's listen to that track. We've all heard it a lot of times, but this time let's really focus in on the bass.
Okay.
So here's Barbra Streisand and Evergreen. I found with you. Have you ever followed the progress of the hits you've played on as they've gone up and down the charts, or were you never really concerned about that?
I've never given. I mean, the only time would be something like Another Day in Paradise, where it seemed like anywhere I went when it was out, it was in the, you know, the grocery store, it was in the gym, it was constantly being played. So if something's getting a ton of airplay, or like when I did 1,000 Miles with Vanessa Carlton, it was on, constantly on everything, and so I would hear it. But for the most part, you know, by the time these things come out, I've already done a half a dozen projects since then, and I don't even follow through with it. I just, you know,
it seems like hitting number one would be a pretty big deal. You could say, Lee Sklar, I've played on 43 number ones or whatever, but if you hit, like, number 14, you know, that's, everybody's just going to forget that.
Well, also, I mean, it doesn't, I just don't think about that. I'm really thrilled to be a gainfully employed musician. That's all I really care about. I really don't care what's number one. I mean, some of the best stuff I played on never even got released.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't even think about it that way.
I don't have a
vested interest in terms of residuals and points in almost anything I've done, so I don't really keep track of it just to see how it's doing so I can anticipate what my mailbox money is going to be.
So really, it's the artistic satisfaction is the reward in itself, and whatever the chart's rated at doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
Well, when Carol Kay was on the show, I asked her if she could instinctively tell when she was playing on a hit record, and she said when she was that the hair on her arms would raise up. She'd have like a physical, electrical response. And I know you've played on a lot of recordings that have hit big and a lot that haven't, so are you also able to tell immediately if a track is destined for greatness?
I guess I'm like the polar opposite of Carol. I mean, I've worked on some stuff I thought was some of the coolest stuff I ever played on, and it didn't get released, and I've done some other stuff that I thought was just kind of paying the bill schlock, and it ends up being like a number one record for 20 weeks.
Yeah.
So I don't have that attunement.
Well, I know you've worked with a number of contemporary Christian artists. Does the vibe in the studio at those sessions seem more sacred and reverent to you, or do the same expletives fly when things don't go well?
It's straight up the same as a regular pop date.
Mm-hmm.
There really isn't that dramatic a difference in any of that. When I would work with Stephen Curtis Chapman and artists like that, it's the process of just making a record, and they have their own, you know, spin on what's important to them in there, and some of the guys, like, you know, they'll be very spiritual in there, but ultimately we're cutting pop music.
It's basically the same job.
Yeah, it's the same job.
Now, well, the next track I'm going to play probably doesn't technically qualify as contemporary Christian, though it does have Jesus in the title. you used the expression polar opposite. I think this is pretty much the polar opposite.
Are we talking about Lukather?
Yeah. This is pretty much the polar opposite of Evergreen. You know, and I doubt anybody would ever guess that the same guy was playing bass on both tracks. So it's a testament to your versatility.
I love this track.
Yeah.
Abe Laboriel Jr. is playing drums on it, and we did it live in one take.
Yeah, I think we'd be doing a disservice to your bass playing if we didn't acknowledge, you know, your killer rock chops. So you can talk about him afterwards, but let's go ahead and listen to you grind one out here with your friend Steve Lukather. This is from his solo album, Ever Changing Times. It's called Jammin' with Jesus.
We'll be right back.
How long have you known Steve Lukather?
Luke and I first met when he was 19 years old, and I was on like one of his very first sessions, and we've been close friends ever since. I love him dearly as a friend and as a musician.
Well, a lot of the albums you've played on have had multiple bass players. Why do you think those artists hired you to play on just a few tracks when you were clearly qualified to play on them all?
I think on a lot of records, what really happens is they, especially in the days, and it's harder nowadays the way things are printed, but they loved having lots of names on their records. And so I would work on projects and I would get a, you know, I'd suddenly see it and it would have Neil Steubenhaus, myself, Nathan East, Abe Laboreal, different Bob Glaub. They would have each of us do a couple of tracks. And I think it was really everybody could have played the whole record.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a matter they love having a bunch of different names on it. They would have Russ Kunkel and Jim Keltner and Jeff Porcaro and mm-hmm. on drums. And I think that's really the nature of it. So I don't think it was anything like anybody was better qualified for those mm-hmm. specific songs. I think it was more that they just wanted to have a who's who on their record. It makes them, in their mind, look better.
Do you think that the album might have felt less cohesive, though, by doing that?
Oh, you know, always. The ones I hate the most are the ones that have, like, five producers on them.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
You know, I mean, you can't find any continuity within the whole thing at that point. It's going from techno to complete raw, you know, grunge to... I mean, it's like, Jesus, you know, figure it out and go with a concept. But there's very little concept. But nowadays, you don't even have to worry about it because there's... so few records actually being made in completion.
It's become a singles market again.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Well, I know you've got a really exciting gig coming up. You're going to be playing in the band at the Academy Awards ceremony. Have you done the Oscars before, or is this going to be
your first time? I'm thrilled, and I get to share my bass seat with Esperanza Spalding, which I'm totally digging.
Oh,
she's
going
to play upright, and I'm playing electric, and Sheila E.'s doing it, and... It's just great. George Deering's playing guitar, Randy Kerber's playing keyboards, John Robinson's playing drums. It's a real fantastic band, and Hans Zimmer is doing the music for it, along with like Giorgio Moroder, and I forget his name, the guy who did the music for Slumdog Millionaire is involved in playing keys. And so it's a pretty interesting assortment here.
Are you going to be in a pit, or are you going to be where we can
see
it?
Well, I think they're mixing it up a little bit. I think we're going to be in the pit, but I think what they're also doing is they're putting cameras in the pit to show the orchestra during the show, and they're not hiding it. They want to embrace the musicians in live music. So.
Well, with the names you just meant, what's the point of having Esperanza Spalding there if you're not going to let everybody know it's her there?
Yeah, there are a few of them. Like they're doing something, I think, with boxes above the stage, the ones where people would be sitting. I think the first two, the first ones on each side, they're going to have Esperanza and two other people in one of those, and Sheila E. and two other people in one of those, mm-hmm. so they're going to... I think Esperanza is going to be playing for the memoriam thing for all the people who passed during this year and stuff. So it's still a work in progress. This weekend we're going in to do all the recording and stuff, and then we're going to be rehearsing all next week, mm-hmm. and then blocking the whole show down at the Kodak Theater, and then a week from this coming Sunday we do it, and then the next morning I start a project with Simon Phillips for an English project, and we're cutting 30 80s songs for an English company. So, you know, it's just a moving target's harder to hit. So
30 songs from the 80s?
Yep. All kinds of stuff, and really cool. It's going to be a lot of fun. And some 60s and 70s, too. We're doing My Generation and all kinds of different things. So it's going to be fun.
You have to be John Entwistle on that track.
Yeah, I get to be John. I have to learn that solo.
It's a memorable classic one. Well, by the time this airs, the Oscars will have come and gone, but it's still nice to get your perspective on what's going to go into producing that from a musical standpoint, and it sounds like it's going to be a little more memorable than past years, so people listening to this right now are probably like, oh, yeah, that was kind of cool this year.
Yeah, I hope so. I hope it's great because we're all really excited about it and feel there's a potential to move it to another level now.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens.
Well, I've got just one more song to play. This was written by Donald Fagen of Steely Dan, and just goes to show how truly spoiled you are when it comes to drummers. I mean, you've mentioned Russ Kunkel, Simon Phillips, Billy Cobham. This one is with Jeff Porcaro.
I love Jeff.
Have you ever done a session like with a less capable drummer and secretly wished to yourself that, you know, Russ or Jeff was playing on it
you
instead?
Oh, yeah, inevitably.
You can't help it, huh? Yeah.
It happens occasionally, but my favorite stuff is like when I walk in and I have no idea who the drummer is, and the guy starts playing, and I fall in love with them. When I did the Latin Grammy Awards this year, Nate Morton was the drummer on it, and Nate's the drummer on the TV show The Voice.
Oh, yeah.
He is a badass drummer and a sweetheart of a guy. So we hit it off immediately, and I had never met him before, so I was thrilled. So more than not, I end up pleasantly surprised rather than disappointed when there's somebody new on the scene.
Well, I have to say, in doing my research for this show, I didn't come across a single negative word that was ever said or written about you, which I think is quite a legacy in itself, in addition to your musical accomplishments.
Well, they're all liars.
If you navigate the music industry for 40 years without making any serious enemies, that's quite an achievement.
I just had them all killed.
I thought it was something like that. That's why I'm trying to kiss up to you now so I don't end up on that list.
Yeah, no, I have a chipper at home, and I'll just go Fargo them.
Well, Lee, I want to thank you for taking the time to share your wisdom with us. It's been a real privilege.
Well, it's an absolute pleasure for me, and any time you want to talk to me, you give me a shout. You got my number.
This podcast was recorded at Mojo Recording Studio in Phoenix, Arizona. As always, it was engineered by Mike Post. Thank you for listening. Now here's the Manhattan Transfer, and Confide in Me. So long, everybody. Brave.